Come on, you got anything any better? You know, you seen them on TV. You want some of me? Come on, devil, you want some of me? Because again, greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world.
We're so excited that you decided to tune in with us.
Amen. We're believing God that God's going to move on your life, no matter where you're at right now. Now, we experience each and every week a powerful anointing here in the sanctuary. We're believing God to somehow, some way, capture that and get that released through the airways. As we heard a brother say, to the cyber saints out there watching this program. And so we encourage you right now, just get ready to receive from the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. We say around here, watch as you are.
You won't be the same.
Thank you. Surely the presence of my heart a couple days ago. And to be honest, I've had a couple people pray with me because I didn't want it to be my thought or my ideal, because my ideal isn't going to, it's not going to help or touch anyone. But it's just been like little confirmation after confirmation. When you first prayed, you prayed about us taking back. And I'm going to take back my dance today. 2 weeks ago, Jordan drew the piece. And she bolded peace. She didn't know what she was doing, but God knew. She bolded peace out. And then Chanda Wednesday, she drew the river. And God laid a song on my heart called Peace Like a River. So just worship with me. I don't want it to just be me up here worshiping. Worship God in the way that He's put it on y'all's heart.
Thank you. You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle that we may proclaim you King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
Come on, Lord. When, I'll get through this. When Brother Gary messaged me yesterday about this video, asking what I thought, and I just got in the car, we was coming to Madisonville, and I started to play it. The Spirit of God got all over me. Whew. I had turned it off. Susie got in the car and said, what's the matter? So I told her, but I did play it in Captain D's.
Sorry.
Volume wide open. There wasn't but 4 or 5 people in there, but they heard it. But you know, here's the most awesome thing about it is what... how God changes what he wants you to say and what he wants you to do. Because actually, this all started about 3-4 weeks ago. My typical morning drive is about 1 hour and 45 minutes or 2 hours some mornings. And so it's just me and God. I don't even play radio anymore. And I had to thank Brother Brent for this because, you know, we all have some awesome testimonies about where we was and where God brought us from. And some of us may think, you know, we don't, you know, I was a good kid and all that. But, you know, really it doesn't matter about that testimony. The testimony that really matters is the one that we are now.
Yes, that's right.
To what we have become, not what we was, but what we have become. But I was sitting there, I was thinking about my life and things that gone through it and how God has put his hands on me. And this lady in this video, I guess what, was so emotional to me. I had a great grandmother, my daddy's mother's mother, called a Grand Mazzy, Grand Mazzy Paris. And what was so special I was to her was we shared the same birthday. And unlike Billy, my hair wasn't quite that long, but she would always used to tease me about wanting to put blue ribbons in my hair. You know, I could see me out playing drums, rock and roll band, you know, blue ribbon. But she always was, when you went to see her, she was sitting in a rocking chair. If she wasn't praying, she had the word in her lap. And so through all my years, I wonder what had kept me to be where I am today. And it, I believe it's from her prayers that she prayed daily for all of us, not just me, but for all of us. And, you know, the things and stuff that we've gone through in our lives. And I started going through my testimony and all that. And then God changes things. And you don't know what you're going to be or where you're going to be on it. And that's what he did on that. And I wound up in James chapter 5. But that's... Oh, glory. Hang on just a second. Thank you, Jesus. And there was some things in my life. And Luke, I want you... You got a mic up there? Because I want you to read. I like Luke's voice. He just... He's so awesome about, you know, that I just do. But I can see now where her prayers, even though she died in 74, that even my life really in my turmoil years, I guess you won't say, was later than that. But, you know, God spoke to my heart back then that, you know, even though these people who are gone, their prayers are still up there, you know. And he gave me confirmation to that. We went to Susie's aunt's funeral over in Illinois, and the pastor that preached her funeral, he said that. So I knew it was true, you know, what God says, you know, even though they're gone, their prayers for us would still be out there interceding for us daily. They just don't go up there. He hears them, he throws away. They're there every day. And I know of that because that's why I'm standing here today, is because of that. And we have things that happen in our lives that we don't understand why or how they happen or why they happen. And then after, it could be many, many years before you can understand. You know, and still, I'm not saying God let it happen and all that, but it did. But it saved my life in 1988. But in when I was in the fifth grade, my sister Marianne, some of you know her, me and my brother Tom, we both got BB guns for Christmas, and we were shooting milk cartons off of a post. And I thought I heard them both go off, but then I raised up and I got a BB in my left eye. But now I got a glass eye now. But the thing of it is, how can something like that save your life? When 1988, I fell, I was about as high as the ceiling is, and I fell to the floor and my head hit a table saw before I hit the ground. And I don't remember nothing of it. You know, thank God that he knocked me out, but I was at Grace Fellowship Church in Morganville. And we had just remodeled it. This was Friday before the first service, and I played drums. And so, only thing I can remember is this saying to myself, this is really gonna hurt. And so I fell and knocked me out. And Susan can testify to that because she's the one who told me. Pat Donahue, he was the administrator at Union County. And at that time, the x-ray room was right next to the cafeteria. And Pat Donahue was in there with Dr. Malubi as they was doing the x-rays and trying to see what kind of damage I heard. But Susie said she could hear, whew. Hear a commotion. So she went and she cracked the door, emergency room, or the x-ray room, and I was in there praying in the spirit, unconsciously, but my spirit man was praying for me. And Dr. Maluba, he was Filipino, he was getting excited. He was saying, we need to lifelight him. There's something going on here with him. He's losing his mind. Pat Donahue, he went to Grace Fellowship where we did. He just said, No, Doc, he's okay. He's just talking to Jesus right now. But it's just so awesome how, you know, if you don't believe in speaking in tongues or any of that, I have to, I don't remember it. Susie heard it, everybody heard it, but it's real. It is real. It is truly real. And the awesome thing about it is, like I said, this was on Friday, and Sunday was our first service. Guess who played drums that Sunday morning? Yes, sir. You know, the devil, you ain't knocked me out of that. Dr. Malubi didn't want me to go and wasn't going to release me, but he did. But I wasn't missing that first service. The devil wasn't going to keep me from that. So I did. I went and played drums, went back. And then went and had MRIs and all that. And we went to a neurosurgeon. We knew a neurosurgeon because he had done Susie's back surgery several years before that. And we were sitting in our examining room. Dr. Dominguez, he opens the door, he shuts the door. He opens the door, he shuts the door. And then he comes in, he looks at me and said, "You should be dead. Nobody takes a blow to the head like you did and lived. But you know what saved my life," he said? "I turned my head to the right to see where I was going to fall. And I took the blow to the side of my head instead of the back. So my eye, being gone, saved my life." Come find out, I do have some brain damage on the right side, but it ain't slowed me down much. I just walk a little funny, you know, sometimes. My left side won't catch up with my right side. But it's just that, you know, little things or things in life that happens that we don't understand, you know, but it did save my life. Yes, I just, you know, got one eye, but I can see out of that. I give God praise and glory. And I had that eye until 2000, I guess, when we moved back, and it had to have it removed. It finally gave up the ghost, and so now I got one I can look at myself with, you know, if I want to. But it's just, today, I just want to share a little bit of that. But today, whenever I got really studying on this, and I thought it was just all going to be about my testimony, and how her prayers pulled me in. I believe it with all my heart that she did. And Luke, go ahead and read it, please, sir. All the way through.
"Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing songs. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayers of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another, and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man of nature like ours. And he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth, and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins."
Go back to verse, 16? But I like that. Whenever we lead somebody to the Lord, you know, we've done, saved another soul, you know. But in the Amplified, I like to read it out of that. The Amplified Bible, I don't know if y'all ever heard of or got one, but several years ago in the early 1800s, John. In the early 1980s, yeah, 1980, older than dirt, older than Johnny May. But in 1980s, when me and Susie, we rededicated our lives, she was going to, a friend of hers got her going to a General Baptist church on Sundays, and I was staying home watching Jimmy Swaggart. And I got rededicated my life. And so we started going to church and all that, and then next thing you know, Susie, I don't know how she got a hold of it first, but she got a hold of the Holy, you know, about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so we went and to a Swagger Crusade, and that's where we received it. And like I said, we was going to Baptist Church, and we was down front on Sunday morning. You know, we was going to receive it or Sunday afternoon. We was standing there, and somebody picked her on the back. It was our preacher's sister. You know, what y'all doing here? You know, well, what are you doing here? You know? But needless to say, we received it, and our lives changed and all that. Oh, Lord. But anyway, let me settle down. Let me settle down. But anyway, getting back to Amplified Bible, we was doing Bible study by Brother Marcharello. It was a monthly book that we got. And he would do these scriptures, and at the end it said TAB. Man, we had to have one of these TABs, whatever it was. And it was Amplified Bible. So this is my second one. It's not as worn as the first one. Because that first one, whenever I fell, I was off work for almost 2 years. And so I was in it daily. She was in hers daily. I mean, there was nothing that got in our way back then. And I said back then because today is so much for me as it is you all that I'm not walking strongly as I wish to be. What? Do you? Cool. Read.
I don't have it up there.
Okay, all right. Do 16, I think.
Therefore, confess your sins to one another, your false steps, your offenses, and pray for one another that you may be healed and restored. The heartfelt and persistent prayer of a righteous man, a believer, can accomplish much. When put into action and made effective by God, it is dynamic and can have tremendous power.
See, that's why it can be dynamic and tremendous power. That's why I said, do we really talk to God when we pray? Are we really down in our guts? I remember being in closets at night, you know, reading and studying the Word and praying to God and feeling it. And it just seems like, I think this is what really has drawn me to this, because over the last few weeks or last 6 months, our lives has changed drastically. I got a new job and all that. We just sold the house, getting another house, smaller house, easier upkeep and all that. And so we're going through a whole lot. But it just seemed like we pray every morning. Don't get me wrong. When I go and wake her up and tell her bye, we pray. But it just seemed like it was just the same thing, repetition over and over and over and over again. You know, God, keep John safe, bring him home, keep him on his side of the road, keep him awake, you know, and all that, and pray for her, you know, God, heal and touch her and all that. I'm not saying that he's not hearing them prayers, but I miss the dynamics of it. There's a time that whenever you, that you know when you pray that you have touched God. I remember, like I said, there was nothing that could get us our way. When we went to bed at night, we worried about nothing because we know God was in control, that he was over our lives, that he was going to keep us safe. And the next day, you know, and all that, it just seems like everything we did, God blessed us. He touched us in one way and another. And he hadn't changed none. Now, don't get me wrong. He hadn't changed none. It's been us, you know. But he still blesses, even though, because he loves us. Even though we may not be where we need to be with him, he's not going to leave us or nothing like that. I remember one time, this was in the 80s, and we was looking at this one house. We used to walk the streets of Sturgis at night, and you know, for exercise. But anyway, there's this one house we looked at, and we kind of liked it, but we didn't. And anyway, one morning, I don't know what time, he woke me up and said, do not buy that house. And I knew it was God's voice. I mean, it was just as audible as what mine is right now. And I said, yes, Lord, and laid down, went back to sleep, and I told Susan the next morning. I said, we're not to buy that house. She said, okay, you know. And so a couple months went on. We was walking down this street, down Kelsey Street, and there was this house for sale. So we called about. We liked the house. I knew the house, knew the lady it lived in. She had fallen and broken her hip. And her son lived in Arizona, came and took her to Arizona. Well, they was wanting $85,000 for that house. We offered them 38. No, offered them 42 and bought the house. You know, that's $40,000 less than what they was asking for. So we knew it was ours. We got it and we remodeled it and lived in it and all that. And here in most recently, last year, two years in September, I seen some property in Sturgis, had a nice big pole barn on it, another house or another building was going to make the house. And this is how God protects you. And we prayed about it. And I thought it was so good because I made them an offer and they took it. Went to the bank, you know, got the loan and all that. But for some reason, they never, ever could get a clear deed to that property. For a year, they tried to get a deed. And then Susie said, we was at Moffett's Lake. And she said, you see that little house in Pride on the corner, got the building? I said, yeah. She said, I kind of like it, don't you? I said, yeah. So we called and checked on it. I went to the realtor, I called the bank. First off, I want to know if my loan was still good, even though it was over a year old. He said, yeah, it's still good. I said, okay, I'm going to offer it on house. The bank that was getting loan on the house, it was in bankruptcy. So I made an offer on it on Friday, and the realtor called me Monday night and said it was ours. You know, if we had bought that other piece of property, I don't think we'd been very happy. He had something a whole lot better and a whole lot nicer than what we was going to have down there. But God still sees us and watches over us and protects us. Oh, Lord. Thanks, Jesus. I'm just going over here. Okay. And you know, Brother Brent, Monday night, I was sitting there listening to him, and he was talking about the windshield preaching. We all do that. I did that for the last 2 weeks. You sit there, you go over this, and then whenever you get up here, Holy Spirit changes your mind. You don't get to preach what you thought you was going to preach. And I get all teary-eyed up and excited and all that. And, you know, people are going to jump up and down out of their seats whenever they hear this. You know, I got this. And then you sit there and you say it and you do it. And you say, what are y'all sitting there for? Do you know? You know, didn't you get it? You know? But what do we really want from God? What do we really want? We wonder why. And I'm not saying because we got situations going on in our life, sickness, health issues and stuff, that we're not touching God's heart. No, I'm not saying that at all. Because God does love us and he does want us to have all that he has to offer for us, his blessings that he pours out daily upon us. I mean, when we wake up in the morning, we may hurt and we may ache and crack, but we're up and we're breathing and we're walking. Some people don't get that privilege. You know, there's some people that was born that never know what a good life is, live to be an old age, and we wonder why. Is it some sin that their parent did? Heaven forbid, you know. It's all for the glory of God. With our relationship with God, it's communication, talking back and forth to each other. Same way in marriage and stuff. You know, Susie, the love of my life, who God gave to me, what, 30, 37? Ain't gonna be 38, keep that up, boy. But I hear it every year. But no, you know, really, God, she is a gift to me, and I give her all the praise. I mean, she's my backbone and all that. We met, and 6-7 weeks later, we was married, you know, and everybody gave us 6 weeks, 6 months, and been 37 years. Sometimes I think you're better off that way. You get to learn each other as you go, but all that. But she's constantly trying to keep me in line, and I really give for it. But I remember back in, she was walking Bible, let me tell you. She still is. If she wants to recall it, she can recall it. But I promise you, I never say, oh man, I cut my finger because we had church. Oh, the hill, you know, all that. That's just the way she was. We'd go over to her mom and dad's house, and Buddy, I mean, she'd lay hands on them and pray for them. But you know, I miss that. I miss that. We let, like Brent said earlier, we let daily things start to consume us and take us over, and we're not giving God the time that He really deserves. And you know, here in the last 6 months, seven, 8 months now, like I say, I got long drives home and long drives to work, and that gives me time to spend with Him. I don't get to read the Word, but it's not so much that, but it's communicating with Him back and forth. You know, God, you know, He shows you things. That's just like this here. This morning I got up and I was going to study up on it, and I just kept on turning to this chapter, this book, this verse, and all that. And God just, you know, more and more and more and more just added on to it. And I just had to close the Bible because, oh, I had to end it somewhere. But what I want to say is, again, it is so, so important that we have a relationship with Him like we have never had a relationship. It's getting too close to the end. And I want to tell y'all something about this church. And me and Brother Billy talked about it. Something about after the outdoor revival. I mean, God is going to pull us to places and take us to places we ain't never thought about before. Pastor Tim talked about going out and ministering more out in the public places and all that. And so we have speak forth what God has laid on His heart to do. So the devil's going to do everything in his power, because believe me, the devil's real. The devil is real. And he's going to put financial situations, vehicle situations, health situations, anything and everything that he can to stop us from doing what he has called us to do, and that's to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to the lost and dying world. And yes, there is many, many people out here just in Providence alone that needs to hear it. And that's what's so great about what Pastor Tim Six Barb does with that barbecue stand. Not only do they feed your flesh, but Lord, you come up, say, pray for me. They'll drop what they're doing. They'll pray for you right there. I believe they feed more spiritual than they do fleshly. But it's a good outreach. Because people come to them there that wouldn't come to the church or wouldn't come to any church, because they think they're not worthy to come to the church, you know, and that they, you know, but they will come there and pray. And that's just like it's easier to minister out on the street than it is in the church, because they're in their own environment and, you know, their own surrounding and all that. And getting in closing here, Susie gave me this little book. I love it. She's had it since November 2012. But it's called Jesus is Calling. And it's laid on my desk at work for 3 or 4 years. Never did pick it up till about 4 months ago when I downloaded it on my phone. But I didn't know when I could share what I need to share of this. And then Brent, he opened the door for it this morning whenever we was doing that song. And he's talking about, you know, you feeling the tugging of your heart. And I want to read this one here, and then a poem that Kimmy Don, she gave me back in 2014. And it says, come to me. What I like about this book, it's just like God is talking to you. It's not a, I won't say a, just a regular devotional, but it's like a personal one-to-one, like He's sitting right there, like, you know, talking to you. It says, come to me continually. I am meant to be the center of your consciousness, the anchor of your soul. Your mind will wander from me, but the question is how far you allow it to wander. Yeah. An anchor on a short rope lets a boat drift slightly before the taut line tugs the boat back towards the center. Similarly, as you drift away from me, my spirit within you gives a tug. Prompting you to return to me. As you become increasingly attuned to my presence, the length of rope on your soul's anchor is shortened. You wander only a short distance before feeling that inner tug, telling you to return to your center in me. And about, I don't know what I said, 2014, I used to go to the lake, as again, used to, but I leave 5:30 in the mornings now. I used to go to the airport late in Sturgis and pray every morning. I used to post pictures on Facebook and all that. And then old Kimmy Don just met her and all that. She says to Brother Johnny, God showed me this poem the first day I met you and Susie, that you said you prayed early mornings, but I was afraid to give it to you because I didn't know y'all. But I come to love y'all. I'm sorry I didn't listen to God the day that you told me you loved me. It says this, I've posted this before on Facebook, but this is so true. I met God in the morning when the day was at its best, and his presence came like glory of the sunrise in my breast. All day long the presence lingered. All day long he stayed with me. And we sailed in perfect calmness over a very troubled sea. Our ships were blown, other ships were blown and battered. Other ships were sore distressed. But the winds that seemed to drive them brought to us a peace and rest. Then I thought of another morning when a keen remorse of mine, when I too had loosened the moorings with the presence left behind. And I think I know the secret, learned from many a troubled way. You must seek God in the morning if you want him to stay through the day.
That's good. That's good.
That is so good. That's why it's so important to get up. That's why we pray in the mornings when we get up. We don't wait to midday, afternoon, something. Even though it, like I say, it may seem so mundane to us, to me it did, but God still hears our prayers. But I just want to get back to where I used to be. I want to get back where I don't have to go to bed worrying at night what's going to be, or get up in the morning worrying what's going to be. I want to know, because greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. And nothing that the devil can come up against us. I hate the devil. I hate to see what the devil does to his kids. And all that. It's time for us to quit being so weak.
Yes. Amen.
It's time for us to quit being so wishy-washy. We come in here to worship today. My Lord, it was good. That was off the cuff, people. I guarantee it. When we got here, we did not know what we was going to do. And we didn't. The only thing we had to do was stand here, and the Holy Spirit did the rest. You know, it was so strong this morning, and we were worried about how it was going to be. We didn't get to practice Wednesday night. And you just, I tell you, I mean, we've been together, singing together for a long time, but it's still something about it. Pastor Tim, he's kind of like the, well, I want to say the backbone of it, you know, the leader of it and all that. But Miss Karen, she filled in on the keyboard. Like Brent said, we don't need him. I just teasing, Brother Tim. Just teasing. Because I know that sometimes he worries about me and Billy, what we'd do whenever he's gone. That's what I told. I called Billy last night, get a little off subject here, but I said, I know one song we want to do. He said, what's that? I said, I heard on radio last night. He said, what's that? I said, Jesus, just all right. Me, Doobie Brothers. He said, all right. He said, all right, we'll get the girls to go, do, 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 do. I said, couldn't you see Brother Tim? Oh, my God, I left him alone again. But the reason why I say that one Wednesday night, they went to Sister Barb's sister's church, I think minister there in Litchfield. Me and Billy came over. I took down my electric drums, put my acousticals up, and he didn't know nothing about it, so we was going to wait and see what the thing was Sunday morning. And he said, you ain't going to believe this. I said, what? He said, they had acoustical drums there, so on the way home to Bars, I wish John set his acoustical drums up. See, that's how the Spirit of God works. You know, they was up, they was ready for him, you know. It just blew their mind, blew ours too, you know, about that. But whenever we're not going to have practice, I say, so we're not having practice Wednesday night. He said, what are y'all going to do? I said, don't worry about it. I said, don't be shocked when you come in. You know? So he kind of grinds whenever they're gone. He's afraid me and Billy going to do something, but we do love him. We aggravate him, but we do love him. We miss him. We mess whenever they're not here. I am sick and tired of the devil. I am tired. I am tired of him trying to tear up marriages. I'm tired of him trying to destroy our kids. And I thank God for Brother Brent and what he has on his heart for our kids. Not only our kids, but adults too, that are struggling with drug addiction and all that. Because we're not as fortunate as in other parts of the country. I was just seen on the news last night, we're out in California, this orchestra conductor, he is teaching little kids violins and all that stuff, and raising up young artists. And they are so enthused at doing that and still running around doing drugs and stuff. They'd rather play their violin. And I just thank God for that. I think that's so awesome. I just pray for the day that we can start having things to get our kids' minds straightened out, get them off of drugs, get them off of video games. You know, we didn't have it so bad like they do today, because we didn't have video games. We played with sticks, you know, and whatever we did outside. But now, you know, they got, I think Billy was talking about last night, so they got thumbs bigger than the rest of their hands because of doing that all the time, you know. But we got to offer them the love of Jesus. Amen. We got to tell them, you know, we don't have to have problems. Pastor Tim's talked about this before. We've tried problems and they failed. Let's try Jesus. Yes. Let them know Jesus loves them. You know, and that there's things, you know, you can get excited about Jesus. Because when you're excited about Jesus, the next person around you can get excited. I love it whenever you just, when you get close to a man, you just know that who he is in Christ, because you're in tune. And you know that you sit there, you see a man's heart. I remember one Sunday, Brother Larry was sitting there. He just had something on him. I just walked up and said, hey, Jesus loves you. That's all I had to say. And whatever was tugging on him broke. He knows Jesus loves him. We all do. But sometimes we just got to have that reassurance that Jesus loves us. It's going to be all right. Jesus has got this. Jesus has got this. Oh, glory to God. When we get where we know we need to be with God, in our prayer life especially, in reading His Word, pray His Word, pray His Word, pray His Word. And then everything will fall in place. I heard George Myers the other day say, you know, sometimes we got to lose all that we got. Whew. So he can give us what he wants. Yes. And that is so true. We go through life, we got to have this, we got to have that, we got this. Trying to fulfill something in our lives. God's love is all that matters to me. God's love, my wife's love, it's all that matters. Because I could care less about the things of this world anymore. I used to think it's what I needed. But I remember when we first got married, it was me and Susie and God. Happy. We're so happy. And you know what? I think what made us so wonderful too, we was walking through it together. We was both learning. On TV we had was TBN. I could not tell you who or what was going on out in the world. We traveled every night somewhere to hear the Word of God, all but Thursday night. Why Thursday night, I don't know, but I know, I remember one time Susie said, man, this Christian life's killing me. But we was getting fed. We loved it. What happened? It's time for that rope to get short. Go ahead, Karen. It's time for that rope to get short. It's time to start reeling it in. Yes. It's time to start loving God the way God wants us to love Him. Appreciating. We all do it. All that have kids and stuff, no matter how they treat us, we're still going to take care of them. That's the way God thinks of us. But it feels so good whenever they come up and say, I love you, Daddy. I love you, Mama. Just to pick up the phone, hear their voice, to know that they're okay. That's all He wants. He just wants to hear our voice. He knows we're okay, but He wants to provide for us. He wants us to give Him to give us all the blessings that He has for us. It may not be monetary things, you know, big houses and all that. We've had that. It doesn't make sense. A home. A house is not a home if there's not love.
That's right. That's right.
That's good. Oh, God. A house is not a home. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. Oh, God. Come to me, all who are burdened, heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take up my yoke. His life. Why do we go throughout this world struggling, bearing down, when we can have peace of God that passes all understanding, no matter what the situation is? I don't care what you throw at me, devil. Try it. Because I read the book.
Yes.
You're defeated.
Yes.
You're a defeated foe, devil. Come on, you got anything in better? You know, you seen them on TV. You want some of me? Come on, devil. You want some of me? Or are we, oh, devil. Oh, woe is me. I want to say, do you want some of me? Because again, greater is He that is in me than he that's in the world. Brother Larry Lee used to do that armor of God. Get up every morning, put on the armor. What do you want to take it off for? Keep it on. That armor had nothing to protect you on the back. It was not designed to turn and run. It was there for attack. And the thing of it is, when you got that shield of faith, that sword of the Spirit, and that helmet of salvation, the devil don't know who's behind it. Greater is He that's in me than he that's in this world. Come on, devil, you want some of me? And I know, devil, you're going to try something this week, but it ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. Because I serve a living God.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God. Oh, God, let's stand to our feet. If you want more of what God has, and that's victory, not defeat, it's time to take a stand against this old slew foot, the devil. And say, here I am, devil. You want some of me? Siska Jessica, she got her dance back. That was so beautiful today. She finally said, devil, enough's enough. I'm taking back what the devil stole from me. I'm taking it back. I'm taking my kids back. I'm taking my family back. I'm taking my income back. Devil, I hate you. I hate you with all that's within me. And it won't be long till the end's going to be coming. I believe it with all my heart. Of course, we've heard it for hundreds of years. But things are lining up, church. We got family members, we got loved ones, we got friends that don't know Jesus. They know about him, but they don't know what he can do for them. But just like Brother Brent said this morning, these altars are open. If you want a stronger, closer walk with him, and I want it for all of you. I want God's peace in all of us. 6 months ago, I made that decision, 8 months ago now, that God, I surrender it all to you. I don't know what you may have in line for me and Susie, but I trust you, and I'll walk the path that you walk. I never look to the right or to the left, but I'll keep my eyes on that cross of Calvary, where over 2,000 years ago he shed his blood so we could be standing here today victorious over the wiles of the enemy. Church, don't live a defeated life. Our old song, they sing victory in Jesus, and there is victory in Jesus.
Folks, we're so glad that you have tuned in with us today. We feel so honored by that.
Amen. We pray that something that was said,
yes,
preached, testified, sung, whatever, yep, may touch your heart. We believe that the power of the Holy Spirit is what changes lives.
Yes.
We know that in his presence is the fullness of joy and the restitution of, yes, all things. In other words, he begins to restore back. And I believe there's things that God's trying to restore back into your lives today. And so we pray that this word is encouraging. We just want to pray, yes, with you before we tune out here. Father God, we just pray right now for all those that have watched. God, I just ask for your Holy Spirit to go and minister to, yes, them, to comfort them right now in the points of needs that they may have. For, yes, those that need healing to their body, God, we pray for healing, yes, right now in Jesus' name. Lord, for those that need salvation, Lord, we pray right now that they ask Jesus into their heart,
yes,
that they say, Lord, forgive me and come into my heart fresh and new.
Yes.
Lord, those that have been backslidden or drawn back,
yes,
to you, God, I just pray right now that you draw them in by your Spirit. And God, I just, Jesus, encourage each and every one out there that they live victoriously,
yes,
and live for Jesus each and every day. And God, we ask these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks again for watching. God bless you.
You can't manifest what God's called you to do trying to mimic and be Pastor Tim or Pastor Barb. You got to be you in the Holy Ghost.